I've decided to keep a journal.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to Pod Casty For Me, the podcast about film, culture, politics, and Paul Schrader, where we watch every film. I feel like I said Paul Schrader. Paul Schrader, where we watch every film written and or directed by American filmmaker Paul Schrader and explore how they speak to their moment in this one. The show is hosted by two guys who think about each other when we go to the bathroom. I'm one of the guys. My name is Jake Serwin.
I'm one of the guys. My name is Ian Ryan. I was just in the bathroom earlier today.
Hey, me too. That's crazy that we've both been to the bathroom today. What kind of stuff were you up to in there? I was brushing my teeth.
I did one of those. Yeah, among other things.
Did you combine?
No.
Are you keeping your... Let's get right to it. Are you keeping your...
Offspring style.
Offspring style.
Keep them separated. Well,
oh, okay. I was going to say, because when you that's one of the things that happens when people combine in some ways.
It's true. Yeah, you're right. Yep.
Are you keeping the toothbrush somewhere safe from the particles?
I am, but it's not because of that. I mean, that's a kind of a nice ancillary benefit. I'm doing that because we don't have like a sort of a nice functional shelf in the bathroom. Okay. So
you have to get yourself a functional shelf, screw it into the wall. That's what I did.
Yeah.
Yeah, I got two of them. And I didn't bother finding the stud, but I didn't put anything that heavy on them. So okay. I think they're fine.
So they're just screwed into drywall? That's wild.
Yeah, big long screws.
It's a wild move. We have houses made of cement here. So I guess that would make me more confident, but it also makes me more scared to drill into the wall because it's forever.
Sure, sure, sure. Unless you get more cement. We're going to get into building materials later in the episode.
Are. Yeah.
We're learning hugely about lots of different cretes.
Mm-hmm.
Hempcrete, aircrete.
Yeah.
Do you know about aircrete?
I know about aircrete.
That's stupid. Aircrete is not our new thing. It's just a different recipe of concrete.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's for those of you who don't know, and I can't imagine it's many. Aircrete is somebody figured out you can get cement mix and mix it with like some basically like foam from a college foam party.
Yeah.
And it makes the cement lighter.
Yeah.
While still having many of the other qualities of cement.
More porous, but there's sealed pores.
Sealed
yeah.
pores. So what is it? What are you talking about? Me? I'm unwashed today. Okay. To try to get into the spirit of things.
That's good. That's good.
We're talking about the Mosquito Coast today. This is a film directed by Peter Weir. That's different.
Okay. Wanted to give you space. Didn't want to trample on anything. Yeah, it is. It's unusual.
But yeah, we're not talking about that yet. We're not there yet.
Okay. Sorry.
We got some other stuff to do. First of all, you like this show so much you can't take it anymore. You might want to go on over to patreon.com/podcastyforme. We've got more content for you. More of us talking to each other. Recently did an episode on Clint Eastwood collaborator Dinky Dean Reisner's 1948 long short film, Bill and Coo.
That's right.
Starring almost entirely a cast of trained birds. And I think as I said on the Patreon post for that, the film looked also into us. I think.
Sure. It's going to be one of the films that I think about the most probably going forward in my life. Honestly.
Yep. I'll be trying to banish it from my thoughts at the moment of my death.
Chase it out of there. Yeah. Yep.
So that someone, you know, my loved ones might fill the void. This is it's an auspicious day. Wait, hold on. Okay. It's time for Paul the News That's Fits a Clint.
Oh, I know what day it is.
Well, it's a couple different auspicious days, actually. Okay. First of all, it is my famous podcast girlfriend's famous podcast birthday.
That's right.
Happy birthday to her. When this comes out, it will be not her birthday by an order of magnitude, but right now it's her birthday. And don't worry, she is out of town on that trip.
Yeah, this would be criminal. This would be an executable crime, capital crime.
Yes. Well, she would probably be at work at this time when we're recording.
That's true.
But happy birthday to her.
Happy birthday.
Auspicious number one.
Mm-hmm.
Auspicious more in the Paul, the News That's Fit to Clint.
Yep.
Type of place of time. I believe as we speak, people are seeing O Canada.
Yeah.
At over there on the Croisette there in France. I prepared a little song for us.
Okay.
Just in honor of the occasion. Oh, it's so
auspicious day.
Whoa.
The book is by Paul Theroux. Oh, such auspicious day. The new film is playing con.
Oh, man.
Think it's can, not actually con.
At what point are you going to just leave us? Your burgeoning career is going to finally tip you into Coachella.
I do need to tell Bill and Coachella. That's got a different word in it. Anyway, yep. I got to tell the folks listening that I can sing better than that. I was doing it for a bit.
Yep.
That was a one take also.
Oh,
so,
hey.
Well, because I right. thought of it about 8 minutes before we started.
Okay. Wow. You made it happen.
Thank you.
The thing is, only 100 people hear it, but every person who hears that song will
take their own life.
Yes.
No. Listen to our Mishima episode, which,
about why
which
you
I
shouldn't do that.
I explain one of the reasons why you should not take your own life.
Airtight.
Aircrete.
Yeah.
So,
we're back.
And then, in terms of Clint news, one of the insane guys who claims that they work for Clint Eastwood and runs a Twitter account with increasingly multiplying watermarks, they posted a video from this, like, it was a sizzle reel for a Clint biopic that was very clearly only sizzle reel. Like, you could tell this was all the footage they shot.
Right.
Like, it's not like a trailer.
No.
And it had some kind of a Fiverr-level guy doing a Morgan Freeman impression to narrate it.
Yeah, it made me sad to watch this.
Yeah, and then it said, that, you know, the post was like, we can now reveal this trailer, and I, within 5 minutes, figured out that it was posted on Vimeo 2018, 2019.
Yeah.
It's been publicly hosted on Vimeo this whole time. So those guys continue to not know what day it is.
I don't know, man. Those guys are...
they're not that funny to me. And the worst thing is, like,
funny. I don't know if it's about funniness. These guys reveal to me, like, a real gap in my knowledge, a void in my understanding of the world. And in that way, they're potent operators.
Well, no, I just mean, like, pointing out that the guys are weird is no longer that funny to me, because I can just see that the ceiling of their relationship to the world as it is so low.
Don't know anything about the construction of that relationship. Where are the walls, ceilings, floor? What's happening over there at all?
What building metaphors around here?
Well, you brought it up.
I'm in my Allie Fox bag.
Okay.
A little bit.
Yeah.
Only positive. Only.
You have an overshirt on. Is that what you mean?
Well, I've got a hat on. I'm unwashed. I've got my shirt that's a Soviet poster.
Yeah, it's a beautiful classic poster. Yeah.
Advocating that people eat corn.
Yep.
And that's a sentiment that I echo. But even more in my Allie Fox bag, immediately prior to recording the song, I had field stripped and was thoroughly cleaning the cat's water fountain.
Great. Yes.
Taking
this is
it
an
apart,
essential
putting it all
job.
Back together again.
Yeah. Did you put in a new filter? Is that to come?
I did.
Oh, great.
I put in a new filter.
Beautiful.
It stopped making noise because it was kind of going.
Yeah, struggling.
I cleaned out the little sponge filter thing, the pre-filter, I guess.
I mean, we're going to talk about it, but cleaning and maintaining things is one of the great individual actions that you can, in fact, take to be a positive type Allie Fox guy.
Yep. So I cleaned that thing out. Felt like Eli Whitney.
Mm-hmm.
Felt like Guglielmo Marconi. This the same level of intellect as those guys.
He loved to...
One of them basically, like, fueled the Civil War. Like, he made a thing that... to, like, make slavery even more efficient.
More necessary also. Labor in a different part of the process. Yeah.
Yeah. So, for that reason, Guglielmo Marconi, you're not invited on the show. A couple different jokes there.
You know what he made? It was that Cuba Gooding Jr. film.
Wait. Okay. I mean, he probably took a boat trip. Are you saying he made a boat trip?
Nope.
Did
I forget who was in the movie? Nope.
I thought you were going to say, you know what he made is that wonderful elbow pasta.
Oh, sure. Yeah. Yankee
now, what
doodle.
Are you, what's your joke, though?
Mine was about the film Radio. Is that not a...
Oh, yeah, that's him. I just forgot about it. There shouldn't be another football movie about an unlikely like hero.
It starts with R and has
and
a,
has
like
a D.
Prominent
like it's
D.
So close to Rudy. Rudio.
Yeah.
Yeah. They got the Taco Tuesdays over there. Anyway, we're doing good on the show. Do you want to do the two questions?
Sure. Yeah. Should I ask you something about Rubios?
Well, if you have something, if that's what you had prepared, but I don't want you to wing it.
Okay.
This is a segment where we ask each other two questions to, you know, sort of just expand the conversation. We're too close to the topic right now. We need to get a little further afield.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Push it. Push out.
I would love for you to go, well, hold on. Is your question like real or stupid?
My question's real, but unimportant.
Oh, mine too. All right, then you go first. Okay. No, it sounds like it doesn't matter.
All right. My question is about basically the encounter that you've had. Well, let me phrase it this way. What is the best vacation relationship that you've formed?
Like with a stranger in a strange land?
Yeah. Yep.
The one that comes to mind is, and I don't, this is just the one that comes to mind.
Okay. All right.
But I was in a train station in Japan.
Mm-hmm.
And we were having a problem, I think, with our ticket or something.
Okay. Yeah.
It's the kind of thing where, like,
you can't see it.
Like, the guidebooks are not equipped for this. Like, you know, where is
this? The train section
ends. How much does it cost?
You move on to Uber, I guess, is next in the big alphabetical topic.
Uber over there. Right. And also, that's Germany. So we're having a problem with the train ticket, and I go to the, like, customer service counter. Mm. And the guy at the customer service counter, his utter lack of knowledge of English, completely dwarfed by his just insane drive to resolve my problem.
Oh, wow. Gorgeous.
And so the two of us are Star Trek style doing dueling Google Translate back and forth.
Just brute forcing it. I love it.
And
what's the year?
The way, this is probably 2016 or 17 or something. Right. And this guy also, one of the things that really charmed me was I was asking him questions at first, because a lot of people who work in like for the train company and stuff in Japan speak a little bit of English. So I did as much Japanese as I could and then asked my question in English.
Sure.
And he gave me a kind of like, I'm going to make a noise. He didn't make a noise. It was totally silent, but I'm going
to
make a noise for the listener.
Yeah, that's
great. Basically went like, hmm? And then I asked it again and his head was still where it was. And he did a kind of, hmm?
He went further. He had to.
He went further.
Wow.
Yeah.
Hell yeah.
Like maybe if I get my ears closer to this guy, I'll start to understand this language.
Sure, sure. Or maybe he's not going to repeat the same thing to me again if I indicate that that's not.
And you know what?
Working for me.
We figured it out so much that I don't even remember what the problem was. I just know it was like a train thing.
He obliterated it from your mind.
Yeah.
That's incredible.
So that guy rules. Shout out to everybody in customer service is a very difficult job.
Particularly if you're working at a public utility where people don't respect you, demand more of it, and somehow think you're more beholden to them.
Yes. I will say that as far as I could tell from my very, very limited brief experience, it seems like people in Japan have a greater amount of respect for the guy who works for the train.
Oh, that's great to
the
hear.
The train than they do in the U.S., where the train is basically an enemy of the people. The train is spat upon. The train is beaten. Right.
And if you work for it, it's like you saying that you work for a garbage can. The very idea is to be ridiculed.
Yeah, although
that's also
some
honorable
people
service.
Who are like 2 or 3 years old, working for the garbage can is basically the greatest thing you can do.
That's true. Yeah.
Yeah.
Never thought about Oscar that being his office. That's very interesting.
I was thinking of the garbage man. You know, love the garbage men
because they do.
They basically drive a dinosaur around.
That's not that a makes fool's logic. That's
no,
deep
of course.
Wisdom.
I just mean they haven't had ideology.
Sure. Yeah.
Squeeze that out of their
they don't
perfect
know about
minds.
Prestige yet.
Yeah. The prestige.
I knew it was coming, but I'm glad that you just kind of shot straight for it. Great.
Yeah. Have you had any special relationships?
I have to reveal something that feels like a great betrayal to you. When I was about 8 years old,
I met somebody I liked a lot better than you. I've always wondered what it'd be like to do a podcast with that guy.
If we're just talking about like the amount of dopamine that was rushing through my brain based on my age, probably, but I don't think that you should take that as a slight against you. It's not a fair fight, you know?
Yep.
This boy's name was Jake. He was a child, me also a child. Yeah. This is why I hate to do this to you. Here's the problem. He delivered in at least one area that I've never even seen you give it a shot. So maybe your chance is still out there.
Basketball?
No. This kid I met at the beach. All right.
Okay.
And he was just a master of all beach activities. All right. The
Did
main
he
one
cover
that
himself
we...
in sand and yep. Doritos and then grab a seagull
face
when it landed on him? Because I've done that.
That last one would have impressed me and would still impress me. Yeah. No, but I meant like skimboarding was the thing that we were doing together.
Oh, yeah. No, I always wanted to try that, but I was too scared.
Well, you're going to feel more scared than ever when you find out about what happened to this Jake.
You have to have like negative BMI to do that. So the kids who are doing that are always...
It's true.
They're
yeah.
like, they don't look malnourished. They just look like, you know, Johnny and Jimmy Skellington.
I mean, he was like a skinny little beach kid, as was I. Yeah. So we were skimboarding about until he broke his arm in front of me while skimboarding.
Whoa, yeah. whoa, I clipped. So that's how it was. Did you see bone?
No, but my father, okay. who is a physician, came and just like...
He said, well, this kid's way too big. Here's your first problem. This bone is... five times longer. Ian's father is a neonatal specialist.
He is, yeah. So any person he meets, he's disgusted by. I think he just like walked him to his, he's like with his grandparents in an RV or something. And he was like, your kid's, your grandson's arm is broken. Mm. And they probably took it from there. I don't remember what happened next. But I felt responsible somehow. And I felt like our Icarus style friendship had come to a really ignominious end. And that was the end of Jake 1, I'll call him.
Jake 1. Well, Jake 2. Hey, number 2 is my name. Number 2 is my game. You know?
That's right.
All right,
what's
cool.
your question, man?
That's fine with me. Thank you for trying to protect my feelings. I think I'm okay about it. But okay. I will be taking up skimboarding. I still think it looks like it might be fun.
I don't even know if it's something that adults can achieve, quite frankly, but give it a shot.
I don't know. I can't really skateboard because of fear.
Sure.
I mean, I can go straight, but the turning is just too scary for me. Yeah,
it's pretty scary.
My question for you, there's one of the many objections that Allie Fox, the lead character of the Mosquito mm-hmm. Coast, has to 1986 America is... He's got a big problem with all this marketing talk.
Yeah.
And now we don't run ads on the show.
Nope. Never will.
And we wouldn't even if anyone asked us. Yep. But, and I'm excluding like cultural production stuff. So you can't say the Criterion Collection or the New York Review of Books or whatever.
Gotcha. Yeah.
What brand do you think would be the most, like the hardest to turn down the opportunity to advertise? Assuming that they're all paying the same amount. I'm just saying like the excitement you'd have to advertise a particular product.
Yeah. No, we have kind of discussed this before off pod, and it's something that I will continue to think about. I don't remember what I decided on.
It hit my head just yesterday. So.
Yep.
Standpipe.
Obviously, my mind goes to the most functional utilities in your home that, like in any society, we just couldn't live without them, and they seem to make them at next to no... marginal profits. So,
oh wow, you're thinking of this as in terms of like still trying to do a social good with the advertisement. I was simply thinking like on Hollywood Handbook when they used to advertise for not driving while high.
Yeah, that's a good one.
I was thinking. I mean, I meant to phrase it in terms of like, you know, don't you love Chobani so much you want to show for Chobani?
But can I separate those? I mean, one of the things I like about Chobani is that they, for last I heard, pay their immigrant workers very well, and it was founded by some type of a
that's good. You Turkish like Yoplait
immigrant.
Then?
I don't. I consume skier yogurt that I can get around here because I'm a big skier head. But
they got Siggy's down there.
They don't have a Siggy. Well, they do actually. I take it back, but it just costs like 3 times as much as in the United States. So that's just off the table.
Yeah.
But I just can't go to the mat for those guys because we talk about lowering consumption of animal goods, and here I am talking about how much
sure.
die for yogurt. So, no, I'm going to return to my original point, which is like Phillips locks or something.
Like a schlage or something like that.
Exactly. Yes, like a schlage. Yeah. Okay. That's quite right. Cool. How about you?
There's a... Now, I haven't done the research into like whether this is an evil company.
Get your ass.
Yeah. So, but there's a particular kind of pilot rollerball pen that I think is just the best pen that there is.
But that's good. I mean, I think
that's something I could stand by.
Yeah.
You know,
we need pens.
Mars ain't the kind of place to raise your kids. In fact, right. It needs moms as hell.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
Yeah. So, I mean, it says there's no one there to raise them.
Yeah, I mean...
Is that what the movie is about? Like, I haven't seen it.
You know what? I have, yes. That's right. I think historically it was famous for no one having seen that film.
I think the next topic of this podcast, and I'm ready to announce it right here.
Okay.
Robert Zemeckis' producing projects only. No direction, no writing.
Hey,
producing only. We're
different
doing
podcast.
Most of the episodes of Tales from the Crypt.
Yeah,
but like probably the ones with the highest budget are all out.
Right.
You know, he did like a spiritual sequel to Paths of Glory with Kirk Douglas.
What?
And the other Douglas kid. There's an episode of Tales from the Crypt that's based on. Like a Two-Fisted Tales comic or something, okay, like one of the adjacent. Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's about like a court martial or like a, you know, like a.
And it's about how war and military bureaucracy is still bad. It continues to be bad.
Well, no, I think it was also set in World War One.
Okay. All right.
Little did they know there was another guy who looked a lot like this guy.
Yeah.
Much older.
Yeah.
Down the street, down the trench.
I mean, they would have been freaked out if they ever saw each other.
And it's got they would have probably blipped out of existence.
Yeah.
It's got the non-Michael Douglas son.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Whom is that?
I forgot what his name is. He died too young in some kind of a sad way.
Okay.
Two-Fisted kind of like Tales. Check out, the film, whatever that show is called. So anyway... Zip, zap, zop. What were we talking about? Mars needs moms.
You know what? How about this? I'm going to do one more because I just saw it on my desk. Probably they also dump chemicals into the ocean that have like eliminated 500 species a day for the last 60 years.
Yeah.
Elmer's glue. Elmer's glue.
Oh, yeah.
Now, that is a glue. You know, I thought I had left this bad boy behind when I put away childish things. Little did I know, it's... Like one of the main ingredients for every woodworker in the world that they will just use. Well,
I was going to say,
straight up,
because you, a lot of people don't, they ask me, like, how does Ian, what does he do down there in Oaxaca?
Uh-huh.
And the answer is slime TikToker. he's the number one.
Yeah.
He's goopy hands 605.
I'm basically the one and only here. I don't mean to dismiss my competitors.
He's got an absolutely incredible set of acrylic nails that the listener can't see.
That's right. The height on them when my hands are flat is just like impossible to conceive of.
Can you imagine how Ali Fox would react to slime content? Like just general sort of...
I mean, he might... go live in a jungle somewhere in Central America.
Yeah, actually, it's pretty easy to imagine how he would react now that I say that. I guess what I really mean is he would hate that too.
Right. Yeah.
This guy would get so mad.
The generator would spin even faster. Yeah.
Yeah. Speaking of which, thank you for answering my question.
Thank you for asking that question.
Yeah.
Let's do it. Let's get into it.
Let's do it. Now, today we're talking The Mosquito Coast, as I mentioned, directed by Peter Weir, came out November 26th, 1986. Happy Thanksgiving, 1986.
Yes.
Now, I put this thing on, and I'm thinking, this doesn't sound like it's going to be scary at all.
Uh-huh.
I mean, how can you probably can't even see the damn thing.
Yeah.
And then the title card comes up, and I realize I misread it.
Sure. Yeah.
Now, this is podcasting.
Unfortunately, you should always have that at the ready. It's your most versatile of all
buddy,
recordings.
It's right there.
Yeah.
Had you seen this before?
No, I'd never seen this before. I had a single lane, a single dimension of relationship to this film, which is that I had seen it at the Blockbuster video near my house. Do you remember this? Do you know nostalgia?
Yeah. Yeah, we used to be... Remember Kool-Aid Man used to be our dad. And
that's right.
Princess Peach was our mommy.
Yeah.
And our food back then, Lunchable.
That's so right. I think you're going to say maybe Peach Kool-Aid. You know what? So what happened
did
is
they
I
have
saw,
that?
I don't know. Saw this Probably. Film at the Blockbuster, and I was so...
But you said you hadn't seen it before. I'm sorry. I gotta cool it. My girlfriend's been gone for like 6 days, and the cats are now speaking fluent English to
sure,
me.
Sure, yeah.
It's...
Yep. Yeah, well, they're getting your jokes, that's for sure, and they're liking them a lot.
They're not liking them, but they are understanding. I can tell that they understand. It looks like it's usually a peach mango flavor of Kool-Aid. I'm going to guess that that is mango forward.
I'm going to guess that too, but I don't touch the stuff. Mm-hmm. So I saw this film, saw the cover, and I forget which parent of mine explained to me that that was my friend, Han Solo.
Oh, wow.
And I thought he looked like absolute shit on the cover, and I hated to look at this movie because that was my friend.
My beautiful boy.
Yeah. Somebody took a really bad picture of him and shared it around. So,
hey, that's your friend. You like that guy. Yeah. Now, it's funny. I had not seen this film either, but I had been planning to for basically the same reason that it repulsed you, because as an adult, I saw Harrison Ford looking disheveled and wearing and bespectacled on a beach, and it seemed like everything had gone wrong for him.
Sure.
And I thought,
why wouldn't
I'm
you
interested
like...
in whatever this movie is.
Well, and also Peter Weir. I should say that I just either like or love many, many Peter Weir films.
Well, you relate so much because you're Peter Weir.
Yeah, that's right.
The sound of you unscrewing your penis to clean it.
All right. So first time for both of us. It is,
first
as you
time
mentioned,
for both of us.
Based on a Paul Theroux novel.
Now, he says Theroux.
Oh, man.
Justin says Theroux.
Okay.
Louis.
I was about to say.
Louis is the son of Paul.
Yeah.
And he says
But he's also the son
Theroux.
Of a British lady.
They both say Theroux. Now, here's the thing. Paul Theroux is from Massachusetts, and he speaks with a sort of half-British accent that his brothers... He's got several brothers who are also, like, authors, public figure types, who say he's full of shit. And, like...
I've also heard this. Yeah.
He's a fucking fancy lad.
Yeah.
So,
I'm gonna... In general, I like to respect people's chosen approaches to their own names.
I'm respecting Louis' pronunciation of it. You know, Paul... His sonny don't jiggle jiggle.
Now this, if you're not familiar with it, is a reference to a little rap that Louis Theroux made.
Yeah,
and it's
so,
really
so,
good.
Yeah, Paul Theroux's son Louis has been
documentarian.
He's established. He's made a cool little lane for himself as a sort of a uptight British guy who goes around and looks at unusual stuff. Often it's like strange subcultures,
all different types of prisons in different places.
Yes, he walks into things as a kind of stuffy, Brit who knows that he's stuffy, a sort of Richard Iowade who has not like signed a open letter that was bad to sign or something. Iowade did something bad, and he was, I think he was in Atlanta, like among some southern rappers, and wrote a little freestyle about how his money don't jiggle jiggle, it folds.
Because it's all
and
cash,
then,
it's all big bills, baby.
Yeah, and he put, first of all, it sounds like this guy hasn't heard about rare coins.
That's true, yeah, good point.
But somebody put it to a beat and became a TikTok sensation.
Yeah, sure did.
Ian did some of his most watched
Slime videos,
slime
to this.
Touching
yes,
to this,
right.
yeah. Put that weird crackly stuff on it.
Uh huh.
Where it kind of looks like it's a.
I mean, it was a 1-to-1 because I make the slime jiggle jiggle, then I fold it and I show that it has sort of properties that defy solid or liquid.
Are you spending a lot of time on TikTok?
I'm not. I am not doing that.
Okay. There's this thing that it's like it's beyond a trend. It's a type of trend. It's a trend.
Wow.
Where people will. and by people, I mean like children.
Right. Mostly. Yeah.
They will, they're like older children.
Okay.
But they're children. They're like 18. They will be lip syncing to like a segment of dialogue from, it usually sounds like it's anime or like the Fairly Odd Parents or something. Like some annoying voice actor voices.
A show that nobody's watched in 18 years. Yeah, go on.
It's coming back right now.
Oh, shit.
But they'll be lip syncing to something, and maybe the audio in the clip is like, I don't know, you never take me to the circus. And then the other person is like, that's because you're stupid. And the first person is like, the circus is, I love the circus or whatever. And like, then, but so they'll be lip syncing to this.
Right.
But they will have captioned it with sort of an adjacent situation that they're hoping people will relate to. So it's okay. Like,
TFW.
Me to my teacher, you, how come we don't get to go on a field trip?
Right.
And the teacher says,
because
your grades aren't good or whatever. And it's like, why do I don't want to hear you. I don't want to hear this fucking cartoon shit. That's not a, talking about.
Yeah. I mean,
why? I mean, it's not for me.
Yeah. That's
in more ways than one.
My takeaway, generally speaking, I don't know.
But I just, the proliferation of people lip syncing to cartoons or whatever. Like, I guess the thing that frustrates me is that I make the association immediately, but I gain nothing from.
Yeah,
listening
it
to
has
this
not
whole
enhanced
clip.
Anything for you. I understand. No. I understand this frustration. Yeah. I mean, this
like
is
the image macro is so much faster. Like you get the point the whole time. But like,
yeah,
I might have to be. You know, this you're putting in a minute of 45 seconds, a minute and a half of like bad lip syncing
for a 6 second idea.
Yes,
basically.
that adds nothing. It accumulates no greater meaning or,
well, I think
or import.
The pleasure is perhaps in the a bit in the mimesis and the reproduction of this scene in a
yeah
in
for
real
them.
World.
It's not for me.
Yeah,
this is why you're not supposed to like jerk off outside.
Or maybe you shouldn't watch somebody's private TikToks that they put online for the world to see.
That really gets it. So I feel like. I mean, I'm really in Ali Fox mode. So we should probably. Do you want to do a brief explainer of the plot of the film?
Oh, sure. Yeah, this is actually one of our more straightforward ones. The film opens. Ali Fox is the paterfamilias. He's the father of four children: two young boys and then younger twin girls. They live in the United States. He is an inventor. He is supposedly working for a farmer who has hired him to create like a cooling system for his barn. Meanwhile, what Ali Fox is really concerned with is the decay of society and the fact that the United States has become a toilet. His objections really run the gamut. We're going to get into them. But everything from advertising, crime, very thinly coded racial objections, all types of stuff, but also
globalization.
Just like, Yep, consumerism, everything. So when he gets fed up with his farmer boss, who doesn't appreciate his super invention of like a little ice machine, basically.
So it's an absorption refrigeration device.
Correct, that's exactly right. So he announces, inspired by the immigrant workers on this farm, that he's going to return to the primitive jungle once they came.
They didn't know how good they had it.
Exactly. Yes. So he's going to go there. He's going to drag his family along, but it's not so much of a drag because the sons look up to him as sort of like a heroic rebel. His wife sees him as this quixotic, passionate, brilliant adventurer type guy.
Yeah. He also looks like Harrison Ford. Which,
he does. So and his wife is Helen Mirren. So they go to the Mosquito Coast somewhere. We're not really sure. Nicaragua, Honduras, whatever.
I think in the book it is canonically Honduras.
Okay.
They're also in the book they are explicitly in Massachusetts.
Yeah.
Although it's filmed very obviously in Georgia. I mean, it's not obvious that it's Georgia. It's obvious that it's not Massachusetts.
Right. Yeah. So they go there. On the way, they meet on the boat another family of people in a parallel but distinct mission, which is Andre Gregory as a reverend, as a sort of like televangelist. Mm-hmm. And his family who go there and they have a church and they engage in a bit of a tete-a-tete about the Bible and, you know, Allie Fox.
The scripture.
Harrison's character tries to flip it on him. Anyway, they get there. They part ways. He goes into the jungle. He manages to buy a village from a German tourist.
Village called Geronimo.
Uh-huh. And they have to go upriver to find this, you know, real Heart of Darkness-y stuff. And they get there. It's like extremely low-resource, hyper-rural community. Barely qualifies as that. It's like, you know, five improvised dwellings in the jungle. Mm-hmm. And he sets up his little utopia where he shows them how to do some sustainable farming. And there's like a lot of low resource, but highly efficient choices that he makes. And he builds this kind of nice place. And then he constructs the real version of his absorption refrigeration invention, whatever. And they use this to make ice.
Fat Boy.
Yes. He calls it Fat Boy after the nuke, of course.
Well, I think it's a combination of the two nukes.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, that's right.
And but that is what I thought. And also, I thought of the ice cream sandwich brand, Fat Boy.
Oh, I don't know about that.
It's a brand of ice cream sandwich that you get at the grocery store or at the ice cream truck or whatever. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I think, oh, this one's got my name on it.
Come on, man.
They're good.
Yeah.
I do think this.
All right.
And then I look in the mirror and I punch myself in the head.
Nope. We don't like that stuff.
Well, sometimes.
And anyway, it's clear that he grows restless and that just the establishment of this community is not enough. It's maybe wasn't the authentic driver. There's maybe some other stuff going on psychologically with this dude. So he comes up with a bunch of other tasks, like bringing some of this ice to truly remote, like an uncontacted tribe. This brings him into contact with some...
Which, oops, they've been contacted.
Right, exactly. With some guys. I'm not sure if in the book there's a clear explanation of... There may be like...
I think they're mercenaries.
Like Contras or something. Yeah.
Yeah.
Like paramilitary Central American guys who want to take over their community.
Well, and they're sort of like ambiguously Central American. Like, it's not entirely clear if they're from Honduras or whatever.
Yeah. No. It doesn't seem like they're... Yeah.
Like foreigners, at least to this part of
Honduras. They're clearly privileged in a way that the local people are not.
Yes.
And to get rid of them, Allie Fox, again, Harrison Ford's character, has to get his son involved in their murder. It goes awry. The giant refrigeration temple gets destroyed. And then they have to move into basically increasingly bleak and separated from society versions of this idea that drive the family to understand that maybe the father is not a figure to be admired, and he's actually quite a cruel man.
He lies to them that the U.S. has been destroyed by a nuclear annihilation.
Exactly, yes, which the oldest boy, River Phoenix, and his wife know not to be true, but is still scary. And then Harrison Ford burns the church down, the aforementioned church, and sets up like a truly ridiculous home on the beach. And there's been this man, Mr. Hattie, who's been sort of like their local guide and admirer
Fixer
and friend.
Guy. Yeah.
And he is the one who sort of swoops in and gives some things to the kid to save them. And at this point, after Harrison Ford has burned down the church and his kids hate him and his wife wants to leave him, the Reverend Andre Gregory's character realizes it's him who lit fire to the church and comes out and shoots him. And the family drifts downriver, lying to the father about like continuing his dream, basically, as he dies.
Beautifully put.
Thank you. Anything I missed any critical elements? What do you think?
I mean, we'll get to them. I don't think...
All right.
So this film is set up, a Schrader takes on the job. It's like purely for hire.
Yep.
He takes on the job while he's in Japan, either trying to get Mishima made or in the middle of it, but he's out of money.
Yeah.
Like,
I think it's right before he leaves, and he's trying to get money up and get some like goodwill on his side.
Right. And on Peter Weir's side, he had been given a copy of the book by Sigourney Weaver on the set of The Year of Living Dangerously, and he liked the book.
Yep.
And I think he was trying to get it put together, and it was taking a while. And then he was offered Witness.
Uh-huh. Also with our buddy Harrison Ford.
Yes. And so that was the first time that they worked together. And that movie's a big hit and a big sort of cultural moment. And I would say Good movie.
Yeah. Oh, me too.
Pretty cool movie. Pretty good movie.
It hadn't occurred to me when you talked about having watched this recently that you're probably doing it in anticipation of this. Or was it just...
I was, okay, yeah.
Smart.
And then I went up to the guy at the Blockbuster and I said, can I get a witness? So yeah, we have a couple of...
Yeah.
No, that didn't happen.
Come on.
Hey, lighten up.
Yep.
So that's a big deal. In fact, they are... it's nominated for a bunch of Oscars, right. But Ford and Weir famously are unable to attend the Oscar ceremony at which they've been nominated because they are in Belize shooting the movie The Mosquito Coast.
About this. Okay. Yeah.
Well, it's one of those things where you read about something and they say that it famously happened, uh-huh. And you're like, well, I mean, how right. much?
Yeah. By whose standard? Yeah.
By whose standards? So Schrader has not really said like a ton about this movie.
Even in Schrader on Schrader, the selection is brief and he mostly talks about the experience being like particularly challenging because you're working for two different people with two different visions, yes. And you have to...
Two masters.
Yeah, so you have to satisfy Paul Theroux and also satisfy Peter Weir and, you know... So,
yeah. Well, and you've got to rob one to pay the other.
Damn, it's true, man.
That's just really thought about good. That.
Okay.
Thanks.
Wow.
I guess let's stop down for a couple hours and go through our notes again to see if this is gonna. But what's funny is that this, you know, he says so much about how if Mishima hadn't existed, he would have wanted to create him. I feel like
Ali Fox
is a very Schraderian character, except like what if the Schrader protagonist had, through, I don't know, cognitive dissonance or something, accidentally found himself with a wife and family,
right.
And then started cracking up. Yep. I mean, he's very Mishima. There's a, well, this is jumping ahead a little bit, but I laughed aloud. There's the scene where, I mean, it's funny for a number of reasons, but where Allie is chainsawing through a log,
yep.
While like going on and on about his understanding of how the world works, uh-huh. And the chainsaw turns on and it just drowns him out, but you can see his mouth is still moving, yeah. And it's just like Mishima with the helicopter.
It is. Yeah, it's identical.
And
yeah.
Then it cuts over to who he's talking to, and it's like a 5-year-old Honduran boy who's
that
like,
only speaks Spanish and is just
yep. It's funny.
Yep.
So it's, I think, of a piece with this.
Oh yeah, it fits right in. Although
it fits right in,
the style, the direction style is so far off from any. I mean, it brought me back closer to a Clint more than a Schrader in terms of kind of like just as trying to effectively tell the story without being showy or drawing attention to the filmmaking itself. Almost
a lot of what I was reading from Peter Weir was he seems uncomfortable with the idea of a Peter Weir style, and like was constantly trying to resist that or do the less obvious thing. I mean, I think this movie, I was watching it with Aaron from Hit Factory.
Terrific.
This movie looks fucking great.
Yeah.
It looks so good. It's shot by this guy, John Seal, which is what the health department does when they come to inspect my bathroom. Uh-huh. No, he's an Australian cinematographer. He has worked with George Miller a number of times on Lorenzo's Oil, Mad Max Fury Road, 3,000 Years of Longing. He's also, he worked on the, to my mind, very important Australian film, BMX Bandits.
Oh, yeah. You know, watch this one
directed by Brian Trenchard Smith, starring a young
Nicole Kidman. Yeah.
And a very obviously male stunt double wearing a big Nicole Kidman wig.
Yeah.
Doing exactly. all her BMX
like,
tricks.
Big shoulders and stuff. Yeah. When they cut them from behind. Yeah. Yeah. Great.
Very funny. He also shot The Hitcher, which is one of the best looking movies that there
Love
is, I think.
Hitcher.
He shot
you put me
Witness, which is how they started working. But he's also like just one of these guys where, for me, I feel like a lot of what looks like a movie, like when you watch a movie, especially from the 1990s, and you think, they just used to just make them look good.
Yeah.
We're shot by this guy, like The Firm. The Talented Mr. Ripley.
I mean, we talk about like Midnight Run, you know, all the time.
Yeah.
This type of film that, just like really nice storytelling. Everything that the camera is doing facilitates the story, and it looks good.
Yes.
And,
yeah. He didn't shoot that, though.
No, but I was giving a type of an example. You know what I mean?
Yeah. He also shot Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone.
Whoa! Yeah.
Like, and The English Patient, which I understand is a good-looking movie. I haven't seen it. Cold Mountain. Rain Man. I'll say this about Rain Man. It has some nice shots of, like, casino lights in it, okay. I guess. And, of course, one of the greatest films ever made, Prince of Persia, The Sands of Time.
That's right. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
He shot that. Your brother. So, shout out to my man, John Seal. And then, also, on the ones and twos, fucking Maurice Jarre.
Yeah, yeah, this is pretty crazy.
The guy who did the music for
David Lean and stuff.
But also Eyes Without a Face.
Yeah, yeah, so crazy.
And Judex. And yeah, he did a bunch of David Lean stuff, including Lawrence of Arabia and Dr. Zhivago. I incidentally saw Lawrence of Arabia in 70mm on Monday.
Wow.
Because it was playing at the Quentin Tarantino's The Vista Theater. Also with Aaron from Hit Factory and some other folks from the old Hit Factory Discord.
Ooh, baby.
Big shout out to Melanie. And I met a guy named Malik there, had not met him before, but now he's in the Discord. So what up Malik? And also, of course, Maurice Jarre scored one of our favorite films on this podcast.
Not true. Incorrect. I was talking about the film of Firefox.
No.
Oh, what?
I was talking about John Frankenheimer's The Extraordinary Seaman.
Yeah. Well, it's very funny of you to have said.
He did do Firefox.
He also did The Train, which I do actually think is a good movie.
I'm going to clip out you saying, that's very funny of you to have said. He did Visconti's The Damned. He did Hitchcock's Topaz. It's just one of these guys who just worked with everybody. He did The Last Tycoon.
Yeah.
Like, what the fuck? Winter Kills. That's a cool movie.
Mm.
With our friend Jeff Bridges.
That's right.
From Tron Legacy. And he had also worked with Peter Weir previously on The Year of Flaming Dangerously and Witness. The Australians were really having a moment. They were really taking, they were taking the world by storm.
Sure.
The culture world by storm. Was that a cat?
No, that was a light coming down.
Ian's had an industrial accident.
That's right. I had an event. All right.
All right, so what else are we talking about? The movie of Mosquito Coast. Where to begin?
Well, I don't know. I mean,
there's lots to go. Well, first of all, the Mosquito Coast. Let's talk about what it is.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's a good way to start. The title.
Because the Classic Mosquito Coast. Technique. Thank you. It refers to a somewhat disputed territory on the eastern coast of Central America that is currently contained in by Honduras, but was previously the claim of Nicaragua.
Yep.
And of course, prior to that was the claim of the Mosquito tribe of indigenous people.
That's right. Yes.
It's actually
who are an extant not named people, after, to be clear. Loves to remind that, like, you know, Mayans are not a type of a dead fantasy
and also,
people.
There was a lot of Mayan, like ruins of the ancient Maya.
Yep.
In this area.
That's right.
Including, apparently, in Belize when they were, like, excavating to build one of the Geronimo sets, they uncovered, like, a Mayan town.
That's
and
wild.
And they had to, like, tell the government, but, yeah, it's not, like, particularly heavier on stinging insects than biting insects,
I mean,
I guess.
Yeah, in English, the people are spelled M-I-S-K-I-T-O, but the place is spelled, like, mosquito, the insect, so...
Interesting.
Well,
which I guess means little fly. Now that I think
that's
about
it, Mosco.
Which I mean, that's true.
It's true. It is true. Yeah.
If you think about it. Yeah. So this is all fairly theoretical for me.
Okay.
But you used to live in like Quintana Roo,
Playa
del Carmen specifically.
That's correct. Yeah.
Which is just up the coast, basically.
Yep.
On the other side of Belize. So they shot this movie in Belize. Because this is like the height of Contra Sandinista U.S. intervention in Latin America under Reagan.
Right. We were extremely busy funding paramilitaries and making drugs.
Well, first of all, let's set some terminology.
Okay.
This is Central America.
Yeah.
Is it also Latin America? Because they speak Spanish.
Yes, it is. It is also Latin America. So it's also North
Latin
America, if you can believe it.
Right. It is. So I guess we'll just... Let's say Central America.
Okay, great.
I don't know. Feels the most specific of all of the terms.
Yep, it's true.
But so are you, did you feel familiar with some of the topography?
Extremely. Obviously, the specific city in which I lived was a mostly a tourist nightmare, but right beyond its borders. Immediately leaving it, you were just in the jungle, and it's a beautiful place, largely being ruined by that same tourist industry, but there's incredible, like, national parks, what they call biosphere, this area called Sian Khan, which has rivers leading from the ocean, much like this. Beautiful. And you can also find a Mayan ruin is basically never farther than, like, 45 minutes to the next Mayan ruin there.
Right. It's like, you know, like Roman stuff in Italy.
Exactly.
Where you're just, like, exactly. tripping over it to get to something else.
And it's incredible. Very beautiful. It is the sweatiest place I've ever lived in my life, and I have
This movie looks so sweaty.
Yeah.
It's just like the soiled linen budget. I mean, I imagine just like if you're the continuity person, the script supervisor or whatever, you just give them 5 minutes. They'll look exactly like they did at the end of yesterday.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's hard not to appreciate it as a manifestation of nature rebelling against colonialism.
Destiny.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah, I mean, well, and I think that's a trend that runs through Peter Weir's filmography. We were talking about this.
We were, yep. With Picnic at Hanging Rock.
Picnic at Hanging Rock, which is basically a movie about the colonized land, like, opening up its mouth and swallowing a bunch of white women out of revenge while no one's looking. And that trend kind of runs through his films. I mean, he's an Australian guy, and to read interviews with him, we were talking about this, it's sort of frustrating, death of the author style. You invoked the that old canard, but he seems uninterested in talking about the fairly strong, if not anti-imperial, like imperial conscious strain throughout all of his, like basically all of his films. I mean, so he does Picnic at Hanging Rock. I haven't seen The Cars That Ate Paris, which is like a sort of exploitation thing.
And then Gallipoli's in there. I don't know how soon
Gallipoli,
after.
Gallipoli, the Year of Living Dangerously, is about an Australian guy who goes to Indonesia.
Okay. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I believe. Then Master and Commander.
Yep.
Much later, but that's, you know,
explicitly about the New World, the white people. Active. Yeah.
Yeah. You also got
Witness is a type of
it's several different layers of kind of white guy adventurer who gets in over his head in a strange and savage land, I guess.
Yeah, and like layers of community in a single place across time, basically. So
yeah,
I mean, the man is so clearly making movies about this stuff, and when we say that it's in his movies, I mean,
The Last Wave as well.
Okay,
that's one of his famous films about a white Australian lawyer who represents some Indigenous Australians and starts to have weird dreams about David Gulbilil.
Yeah, I've heard about this. There's like, is this one with murders? No, I'm confusing with something else.
There is one strange, like sort of bizarre murder, and he's representing some Aboriginal guys who are like, they live in the city, and so there's this whole kind of, well, they're just like us, mate.
Yeah.
And then there's also some kind of, no, there's maybe connections to their own culture. And of course, the white guy starts having dreams.
Indigenous dreams.
I mean, the dreaming. Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, this is sort of there's a concept from Aboriginal Australian culture.
No, yeah.
Yeah. I've watched half of the film. Excited to find out what happens in the second half.
Great. Yeah, but in this film, I mean, truly from, I don't know, 4 or 5 minutes in, Ali is talking about the fact that there's, I mean, again, like implications that the cultural homogeneity of the United States is being disrupted by people arriving from other places, but also simultaneously that those places represent like a noble savage world that the people, like you said, they don't know what they left behind. They don't know what they're missing. And when he goes, I mean, he buys the town from a German tourist. This is like
a drunk German,
the
guy,
great division of Africa happening on screen, basically.
Right.
So it's extremely difficult to believe that he doesn't know about this. But even if he doesn't, then this is where I come in and I say, this movie is about colonialism. This movie is about empire.
Of course. It's a guy colonizing. I mean, it has so much in common with Aguirre, The Wrath of God.
Right.
I have a tag on Letterboxd that I use called Madness in the Jungle.
Yep.
That's like Aguirre, Fitzcarraldo, this movie,
Apocalypse Now.
Apocalypse Now, Predator, yeah. also included there. Yeah. There's one, The Emerald Forest, the John Borman movie, yeah. The Emerald yeah. Forest. Yeah. And this is, yeah, this is, especially at this time, I think, as a way to, David Ehrlich gave O Canada 2.5 stars.
Ooh.
Masterpiece incoming. I don't know. That's okay. Fine. The what the fuck was it? Oh, I think there's a, especially at this point, like geopolitically, you get a lot of movies about the jungle, both as a way of trying to explain Vietnam and yeah. also understanding U.S. intervention in Central America, which is itself one of the kind of trying to cure Vietnam syndrome things.
Right. We're like 2 decades into Operation Condor, and also this is right in the midst of the shift from old school colonialism to neocolonialism in the form of extension of markets and IMF yeah. support for places, structural adjustment policies.
Neocolonialism will be our guest on
That's true. Right. Yep.
We tried to get him on this one. It would have been made a lot God. More sense.
Yeah, I would have loved it. But
but nice. I guess, yeah, we'll be talking light of day with neocolonialism. Yeah. Who knows?
Yeah, and the fact that, I mean, this place is not, it's like this in real life, so it's not like he invented this, and it's in the Paul Theroux novel, but the fact that it's a place that is occupied by historical indigenous people and a group of people that represent the Mosquito, Zambu, or Sambo, I'm not sure how it's pronounced contemporaneously, but...
Yeah, well, it's because, and I'm not as familiar with Eastern, I mean, I'm not really familiar with much at all, but... the eastern coast of Central America yeah. is, this is where you get into
like Afro-Caribbean identities and yeah,
Caribbean.
British Honduras and stuff. Yeah.
Well, and Belize is still a Commonwealth country. It's basically, right. it was like the mainland sort of sister of Jamaica.
Yep.
And so there's a huge population of the descendants of Africans who were brought over.
Yeah, like Afro-Latino people or Afro-Indigenous people. I mean, from what I understand,
enslaved.
The Mosquito Sambu people are at least the sort of, I don't know if it's a narrative or a legend at this point, but it was like one slave ship or a group of slave ships that
like
people escaped from.
Shipwrecked or
yeah,
something,
and
yeah.
they came up like aground and started to intermarry, I don't know how peacefully, but with local right. people, and they created like a separate tribe that then... sort of was in contention with the original Mosquito people.
Right. There's a term to distinguish like the Mosquito Zambu people, the other less intermarried
uh-huh.
group or whatever, sometimes referred to as, I think it translates to straight hair
yeah.
mosquito.
Yep, exactly.
Which is yeah. mildly uncomfortable, but
it
gives
is,
you a sense
of
how entwined.
Right, how racialized like, these divisions are.
Yes.
Yeah, for sure. So the fact that this is the locale for all this happening, again, to me, this is like undeniable discussion of basically all the types of colonial. I mean, if they had, we were just short of having like East Asian people in there somehow, and then we would have covered like
right.
all the types of famous colonialism.
Yeah. I mean, South, don't forget South.
Yep. You're right. I guess I should have said Asian.
And people. Southeast.
Yeah. It's true.
Hell, I could probably come up with a couple more.
Yep.
Well, no, that should put me on the spot. You know, interestingly, and this is maybe neither here nor anywhere, but I was looking at IMDb, the famous internet movie database. Yep. We know it. We love it.
Yeah.
And today we're brought to you by ultimately Amazon. No, I'm kidding.
That's right. Yeah. Web services.
They just own IMDb.
Oh, wow. Sucks.
Yeah. That's why it sucks. That's why it like distinctly sucks now. And they're always pushing Amazon original stuff.
Yeah. I've noticed this.
And honestly... some of those Amazon original guys, they've been colonized as well.
That's true. Yeah, you're right.
I was looking at Amazon. I was looking at IMDb. And there's a keyword, like a plot keyword, back to nature, which was the first keyword that came up with Mosquito Coast. And I clicked on it.
And where do we find nature if not where brown people are?
Well, but that's the thing.
Okay.
Because so many of the movies, when you click on Back to Nature, are Finnish comedies.
Whoa. Okay.
And I think there's just something in Finland.
Huh.
And honestly, well, I mean, there's the Sami people are
yes.
themselves yep. sort of internally colonized, but there seems to be a big thing in Finnish comedies of like dads who say, you know what, we're leaving...
Wow.
The hustle and bustle of Helsinki, and
Mosquito
we're going to go live
Coast
in fucking...
2 through 9 in Finland.
Yeah, Mosquito
Very cool.
Coast North.
Yeah.
Yeah.
A lot of sauna stuff happening, I assume.
Probably. I learned that Norwegian families shower together to conserve water.
Yeah, well.
This is water conservation gone too far. I say recycle the water.
Okay.
Just
well,
use it over again.
I mean, I'm curious. I will also say, despite my previous, if you're listening to the Patreon, I've certainly talked about water conservation. There are some places in the world where you don't really have to worry about water conservation that much. So,
yeah.
I'm wondering if Norway is one of those places. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, especially if you could probably shower with seawater if you filter it.
Talking about like desalination, the famously extremely expensive thing to do.
I'm going to figure it out.
Okay. I mean, what I would say is that
me and Kevin Costner, they
could install a gray water system to like recycle their shower water in their toilets and then probably take separate showers if they want to.
Yeah.
But it's up to them.
If they want to. Just get a bunch of, get some like weird kinds of rock that like, go to the aquarium store. They got all the kinds of all the naturally filtering types of rock that you could ever possibly need. So anyway, if someone listening to this is Finnish, what's up with that? Write us at podcastyforme@gmail.com. Not what's up with being Finnish,
no,
specifically
the
Finnish
back to nature sure, yeah.
comedy.
I get it.
There is a what's Aki Kaurismäki's brother's name? Micah?
I don't even know about this guy. Is he also a filmmaker?
Wait, is his name... His name isn't fucker Kaurismäki, is it? No, Micah. Yeah, it's Micah Kaurismäki. He directed a movie in 1990 called Amazon, which is about...
Interesting.
A Finnish businessman who goes to Brazil to basically, like... start a gold mining operation or whatever. Okay. But like the Finnish back to nature comedy is not excluded from neocolonialism.
No, it's storied. Yeah, man, it's 1990. Okay. Interesting.
Interesting. Interesting stuff. It could be cool. Might be cool.
Yeah.
Patreon. I don't know. But I feel like there's too much to talk about. Let's talk about you.
Okay. All right, sure.
Because you're kind of Ally Fox type.
Yeah,
just kidding.
I'm a light Ally Fox, but I did share with you that the circles that I run in, both online and in person, are rife with...
And we've been meaning to talk to your owner about getting that chain a little longer so you can do maybe
Thank
a square
you so much. Yeah.
around the spike.
That'd be great, yeah. There's some Ally Foxes out there, man. I've met them, and I've talked to them, and I've read their books, and I've watched their videos, and it is a... very difficult to grade process of how you transition, or maybe it's not even a transition because there's like too many dimensions. It's like one of those little pentagram things where like the different qualities are extended to the different amounts. Do you know what I'm talking about?
And I'm nude and I'm in the middle of following so far.
That's right.
There's candles.
Yeah. So these guys, they do.
Yeah. I mean, well, I think what. Perhaps what you're gesturing toward is I see in Ally Fox, I see in the Harrison Ford character, so many recognizable guy types.
Yeah.
From now.
And a mix of positive traits that are truly in their minds, not extractable from a bunch of sometimes to me, like logically conflicting, but
equally strong
ideas about, I was texting you. So, you know, you're mixing together like sustainable farming with my kids are not going to be gender indoctrinated at school, or the internet is going to be shut down one of these days. And if you're not prepared, that's your fault. And also, we just want to talk about like sustainable canning, like home canning, which can be cool.
Right. Well, I think it can.
Yep.
It can.
Mm-hmm.
I was reading about the history of canning yesterday, unrelatedly, actually.
Okay.
This is true.
Wow.
And one of the guy who's considered the father of canning, whose name is...
Tom
Botulism. Do you know
what the guy's
name? Alf. That's the guy they cut out of the Lord of the Rings.
He's kind of a back-to-nature guy, that Tom Bombadil.
I mean, he never left.
Yeah, that's true.
My dude. Sorry, wait. I'm looking up the father of canning. His name is Nicholas Appert. Nicholas Appert, who was a French confectioner and inventor in the early 1800s, who basically, he invented food preservation prior to the germ theory of disease.
Whoa.
Like he just sort of,
just
he didn't
like
know
felt
why it
out.
Worked.
Yeah. I love that.
Yeah.
I love that stuff.
But he, initially, he used old champagne bottles that he would seal with a mixture of mineral lime and cheese.
Oh, that is sick, man.
He's just making that his own glue, I guess.
Nasty.
He's okay. Also, I guess, one of the first slime guys, too. Fellow
slimesman, yeah.
Slimesman.
Yeah.
Wichita slimesman.
That's right. That sucks, slimesman.
Oh, yeah. Well, very much so, yeah. I would assume, from the smell.
So, yeah, I mean... You know, it's interesting. We got Andre Gregor in this film. What if you've seen My Dinner with Andre? He's guy can't shut up about Findhorn. These guys have been around, you know. And
right,
the thing
guys,
is,
well, people looking at taking a look at modern society and seeing obviously something is not working,
and also seeing like specific things about resource usage and saying this isn't working, and yeah. Then tagging in a bunch of stuff that's, I would say, not at all related, but to them,
right?
Like, part
where,
of the same.
How are these guys missing Carl?
Right. Yep. I don't know. This is the big problem. Yeah.
And the guy, I mean, you know how when you encounter a bear or a large wild animal in the in nature,
hey,
one of the things you're supposed to do is make yourself look as big as possible.
Right.
Karl Marx is doing this with his hair and beard.
Yeah, sure.
It's not like he's hiding.
Nope. He's around and he's trying to explain some of where this bad stuff comes from.
Yes.
We can dive into whichever ones are of interest to you, but the stuff that he seems to be objecting to in here...
Allie Fox, you mean.
Allie Fox. He is objecting to, like, construction, modern construction. He is objecting to suburban design and also consumption habits. He is objecting to specifically, like, pollution. I mean, he doesn't name-check greenhouse gases, but he talks about various types
of... Right, well, it's all tied in there with, like... We're being fed slop that is poisoning us and is also poisoning the natural world. But
right.
there's a through line with Allie, and it becomes like very explicit at the end of the film when with his obsession with going upriver. There's as I see it, kind of two ways of being a back to nature or reimagining
society
guy. Yeah. There is the dominance kind and
how do I be the most right? How do I be the truest, right. The best?
And also, he's still trying to conquer nature. Like
right.
He's trying to bring ice to the jungle.
Yes.
You know? So there's that kind, and then there is the how can I best take advantage of processes that occur without human intervention? How can I sort of live in harmony with
What's interesting is I think he initially is
nature.
Like that and then moves away from it. I mean, he also sets up like a water turbine. He has like, you know, he's getting energy from the river in an entirely sustainable way. And he builds these greenhouses, like polyculture greenhouses. And he is living with nature, at least for a while. I mean, until he accidentally dumps a bunch of ammonium hydroxide into the river.
Right. Well, and his whole thing is ice is civilization.
Right.
Which reminds me of something. I don't know if he invented this or if this is something that that other people have said, but Jamel Bowie, the writer and podcaster, said something about, you know, like the strongest kind of ideological power of the US military is the how you can get it has the resources and the infrastructure to get fresh lobster to any point on planet Earth.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah.
And
yeah.
I, you know, so to me, this kind of refrigeration and climate control comfort is like intertwined with the imperial project in a way.
Oh, totally.
I mean, it's literally bringing the climate of Europe to the global south.
Right. I mean, you could argue that greenhouses, I think, do have their place in sustainable farming, but you can also just grow crops that grow in the place where you live and they don't require you to build a greenhouse.
Mm.
But I think you're right in saying that this stuff doesn't entirely track, because on the one hand, he is talking about and fetishizing the lifestyle of people who live so close to the earth. But he's also talking about how he thinks, like you're saying, ISIS civilization, America has fallen because
it's... ISIS civilization? Because I'm... willing to follow you.
Okay, sure.
Where are we going with
Egypt? Probably.
Fuck.
So, but he's also talking about, like, you know, there's a line in the film where he says, "I love America more than anybody. That's why I can't bear to watch it die." So there is
right.
There's a confusion where these people who are upset about the decay of society, they're always talking about like rising crime, and of course, got to throw out the famous and famously true statistic, like since 1993. I think most types of crime have fallen by more than half, some categories by like 70 or 80%. And yet, year to year, Gallup polls suggest that like 60% of people think that crime is on the rise. So people Right. think that things are getting more dangerous. Obviously, this is heavily racialized. Obviously, this is related to low-income communities, homelessness, all Right. these things that get mixed together. So America is being ruined, which means there was some good version of America. And yet also, we need to go back to this thing that's Right. like apart from Western civilization. So
and the only way to do that is in these sort of global South, these places where
Right.
American dollars will allow apparently a sort of itinerant, oppositional defiant disorder.
Yes, exactly.
Having Yeah. inventor to go buy a town from some other jackass.
Yeah, because you can be like Carnegie on a middle class income, basically.
Right.
And just create model towns or whatever.
There's a line in early in the film that I think is illuminating where Allie takes his sons into the home of one of the migrant workers
in the United States
on Polsky's Yeah. farm. Yeah. Yeah. And he just like lets himself in, first of all. Right. And there's food on the table. And he says, look at this. They don't even eat the asparagus that they grow.
Uh-huh.
But there's an immediate judgment on his part that is their choice and not perhaps that.
Actually, I didn't read it that way. I thought that was
How did you say?
I thought that was a critique of society, sort of like, it would make the most sense for these people to be eating this, but isn't it sad?
Oh, sure.
Isn't it sad that they are, the farmer sells this at three times the price and they have to buy McDonald's or like junk
right,
food?
Right. No, we're agreeing.
Okay.
I mean, what I'm saying is that he doesn't make the, I guess. So what you're saying is that you see him as identifying the economic.
Right. I think so. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. But it's this weird mix of condescension and also legitimate critique, which is part of the problem with these guys, right? Buried in here is a real critique of saying it's ridiculous that we're shipping food out somewhere
Right.
and the high quality food that they are producing is not something that they partake in.
It's essentially, I mean, it's antisocial.
Right.
Like his form of prepperism or whatever.
Yeah, which it is, yeah.
Is me and my family who I treat as like pets and employees
Yeah.
combined. Like, we are going to have our own fully self-contained little castle where we don't need to interact with anyone else because they're all degenerates or stupider than me or going to kill me or whatever.
Yes, exactly.
I was looking at, I spent some time looking at luxury bomb shelters.
Okay.
Highly, highly do not recommend this.
Yeah, no, that sounds like a real nightmare. I mean, what I was going to say is that the thing about this type of like you're saying, isolationist prepper lifestyle is that they will also put it forward to me pretty much 95% of the time as saying like, everybody should be doing this. If your eyes were open, you would do this. I have some news about the amount of habitable land on Earth. So if you remove like mountains and deserts, I think at this point with the 8 billion people on Earth, there is about 1.95 acres of like livable territory per person. Now,
1.95.
Yeah. That would mean for everybody to have like a little homestead, like these people imagine, we would of course have to destroy all nature in the world. And then you would have a very small home and you would have to have a negative birth rate or a zero birth rate to maintain that. So
that is
not possible or desirable. Guess what? Cities, dense urban living is extremely sustainable. And that is probably where most of our resources should go. And obviously, I like thinking about how to make a sustainable urban lifestyle, how to create a form of agriculture that doesn't ruin the planet, basically. But
yeah,
that should be basically as few people as possible as we can get out there while also maintaining sustainable agriculture, which may be more people than are in rural areas right now. I'm not sure. But basically, getting people out of cities is creating a burden of construction, transportation, delivery of goods, delivery of utilities, wasteful land use. I mean, this is why the suburbs are the true blight of the world. I will say on this podcast what I feel guilty talking about amongst many of the people that I grew up with and love. The use of land for your private little like English manor estate in miniature is insane.
Right.
It is something that is not reproducible. And if we try to do that, then the earth will be ruined. I don't know how else to put it.
That's what campgrounds are for.
Yeah.
Just go visit, dude.
Right. That's a way more sustainable option to say urban parks or national ideally, parks or whatever.
Yeah, ideally you take a train.
Yeah,
something sustainable to get out to the. But yeah, go to the you know, how about like a cabin that we all share and right. you book it for a weekend or two.
That is a beautiful solution. And the only people who are living out there are people who are either actively contributing to agriculture or like forest protection or something.
Yeah, somebody's got to keep up the cabin.
Yeah. Or exactly.
Or trail maintenance. Right. Or whatever.
Somebody who does something adjacent to those things, runs the rural school or whatever.
The guy who deals to the cocaine bear.
Yes, that's exactly right.
Yeah. Remember him?
Yeah, I do, just barely.
He's got a new movie out.
Oh,
Cocaine Bear.
Another? Oh, okay.
Yeah, he's in.
What would he be in?
The Fall Guy.
I saw the TV. Oh, okay, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
What's the new Alice Walker movie? What's it called?
Like Chimera?
Yeah, that's it. He'd be pretty funny if he was in that movie. Huh?
Yeah, I mean, who's to say he's not? So, yeah, I mean, I think about this because, look, far be it for me to criticize anybody for finding it frustrating and disturbing and upsetting to be around other people sometimes.
Sure, of course.
A lot of the time, even. But that's the difference between me and an Allie Fox type is that I know that is ultimately a me problem and not a them problem.
Yeah, or just a fact of humanity having to live together, that sometimes you have to be uncomfortable. And that's tough, but it's undeniable. I'm sorry to say. I wish I could tell people that their weird little dream is possible.
But I also just like, you gotta do everything.
Yeah. I mean,
there's a thing that's come up in other movies from around this time that I can't think of any off the top of my head, but I have a gut sense that this is a real observation I've made. There was a period where, especially this type of white guy, like maybe falling down Michael Douglas as well.
Right.
And like white dads generally, they got so mad about have a nice day. Like this was some kind of
this was part of the culture war. This is
ideological
one of the battlefields.
Flashpoint.
Yeah.
And I don't really know what it is. Is it the kind of, I mean, if they're objecting to the sort of giving a warm, friendly face to advertising and to consumerism, like I think that's part of objecting to that.
Again, is confusing. Yeah, that part's good to say that we are being sold stuff with a smile that we shouldn't accept that way. But it's also,
right.
I think, just one of these weird little hills that they choose to say, like, this demonstrates. I mean, this is, I'm sorry to do this to you. This is their Fairly Odd Parents TikTok video that they just say, like, if this is happening, it must mean that things have past beyond the pale. This is like truly.
Did I say that things are past beyond the pale? Because I meant to simply say I feel maybe passed over.
Sure,
I feel
sure,
left
sure.
behind, and I no longer understand why people do this. And I it's confusing to me that somebody would spend their time doing this. But maybe that's just me. Maybe
You're
that
right.
means I'm too old.
I'm
yeah.
just having a fun with you. But
you're having a piss, taking a laugh.
That's right. Yeah, but it is. I mean. You know, I'm not saying I've never laughed at a George Carlin joke, but it's the type of thing like that would be the whole joke.
I might say that.
Okay. That would be the whole joke to say like, hey, you know, you go to the hospital and you have your arm's broken. And when you leave, they tell you to have a nice day. Can you imagine this?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I'm kind of reminded of, do you remember that probably like Am I the Asshole post or something? It was some Reddit thing that went that took fire.
Okay.
Took fire. What? That caught
took
fire.
Heavy fire, yeah.
Yeah. Pinned down.
Yeah, go on.
Where there was a woman who, like, there were a bunch of college kids who had moved into, or like recent college graduates who had moved into the apartment next door to her.
Okay.
And she brought them food.
Oh, yes, I remember
to
this.
To welcome them. Yeah. And people were saying this is like essentially violence because you're indicating that they can't take care of themselves or something.
Yeah, and she had come like twice. And it was like, if I already told her no once. Yes, this is what happens to me. I guess now I am being a little bit Allie Fox, where if you just go to a place where people are interacting all the time, this is also like the disintegration of third places in society. Mm-hmm. You know, like people where... places
where
we're people
not giving
are,
out bronze medals anymore.
That's right. Yeah, everybody getting the damn first place trophy ribbon.
Or second, I guess.
Yeah. No, third place is in like parks, cafes. Right, I know right, you know what right. I mean. But
Places
churches,
where you
whatever.
Can you can spend your time that are not based on you spending money
exactly.
to be there.
Yes, you being yes. of a certain class or something. Or
the public sphere right. that is not, yeah, it's not ticketed or yes. paid admission.
And these are places where you are forced into contact with people who are maybe just going to offer you some food because their age or cultural background or even just specific personality incline them towards this behavior. And you can learn to recognize it even when you don't like baked ziti's as just like a gesture of neighborly goodwill and just learn to right. live however you like to. I'm not saying you have to accept the food. That's what I would do. But learning to say like, hey, no, yeah, thank you so much. But like maybe you'd offer them something else in return. You know, you'd make a gesture that indicates to them that you understand the purpose of this socialization.
Right. I mean, it does leave me scratching the old noodle
yeah.
whenever somebody
the old Marconi.
Has... I'm scratching it with the damn fork trying to get it out of the bowl. You know how sometimes you get a little,
yeah,
little pasta in there?
Yeah, it's stuck to the side of the bowl and stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. Because when Ian was here last, he left a jar of something red in the fridge that I thought was sauce, but maybe it was for some of his videos.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Okay. No, I was... It's something that leaves me kind of confused is just whenever anybody has like a social interaction that they don't fully understand... And they don't just kind of nod and
yeah.
try to be polite yep. about it and then go complain about it to their friends later. That's what your friend is for, to uh-huh. say, like, this fucking guy, he should get his fucking head cut off and then put back on backwards and cut off again. I hate
right.
this fucking guy.
Yeah.
I want to invent a new type of gun to put in his ass. I hate this guy.
Okay.
He's the worst piece of shit in the world because the guy was a little weird about, like... Like, I held the door for him and he acted like that was gay or something.
Yeah,
you
yeah,
know?
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
That's for private talk.
Yep.
Instead of losing it, going public freakout mode.
But I also do think that this is part of a pattern of not the Ali Fox guys, but I guess the other guys, the other problematic guys, which is not wanting to allow any amount of discomfort into your life. And basically anything
right.
is justifiable if it means that it is removing this discomfort. So... paying
yeah.
for like an HVAC system that uses 35%
yeah.
of
yeah, yeah.
of US residential energy per year or whatever is like we just have
right.
to have that. There's just simply no way that I would not have that.
I've been reading a lot about coefficients of performance.
Oh baby. Yeah, 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 yeah.
Is that what that stands for?
Oh, yeah.
COP?
Yep.
Yeah, I've been reading a lot about ways to because look, I don't like sweating.
Nobody does.
And I think about
Nobody
this.
Does.
I think about this. Well, some people are more comfortable with it than others, I guess.
That's true.
I've been thinking about this and, you know, the world is getting warmer.
Yep.
We'll eventually no longer be able to sustain life. I don't know. It seems a little hard to pin down for certain when that's going to be.
Sure,
but
yeah.
it's in the future. It's not right now.
Nope.
That's for sure. But I think about, well, there are places that are so cold now that when they warm up, maybe they will be closer to comfortable for me.
That is what they say. Yeah,
and
Northern Canada, et cetera.
I think about this. And then I also think about, honestly, I think about an episode of, I believe, Modern Marvels that
okay.
I saw on the History Channel or whatever channel that show was on. When I came home from high school, I believe I was in 9th or 10th grade. I came home, sat down to do my algebra homework or something.
Uh-huh.
And I put the TV on because I used to do that. I don't know. And I used to do math problems
sure.
in front of the television.
Yeah, normal.
Put my Totino's pizza rolls in the oven or something.
Mm-hmm.
And
your dad.
They were talking about these.
Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah. And we were in the middle of litigation with him about paying
no.
for some of the property damage. And
yeah.
I was like, but dude, you can't be here.
Yeah.
Like, I know,
yeah.
like, we're cool, but like, my parents are going to get home. They're going to be so mad.
Yeah.
Anyway, there's a Nazi salt mine. There's a salt mine
okay.
in Poland where the
wow.
Nazis put all of their plundered art
ah,
because
the
it is
humidity
it was
is
low
so
humidity
low. Yeah.
and naturally 55 degrees
wow.
year round
okay.
under the ground.
All right.
And I've been thinking about this.
Anybody moved in there?
Well, there's a lot of fucking ground that you could go under.
Sure.
My man.
Well, now you're getting into dangerous territory because this is quite literally, I believe, an idea of our old friend. You know which friend of ours this is?
Hitler? I mean, because
no,
of the Nazi thing,
no.
I just said it. Oh. What, Jordan Peterson or something? Mishima?
No, Elon Musk. Elon Musk.
Elon Musk.
Yeah.
No, here's Here's my compromise, though.
Okay.
Because I also sometimes on YouTube, I will watch videos of people building shipping container houses.
Sure. Yes. There you go.
And one of the things that you can do is you find yourself a nice hillside.
Yeah. Yeah.
You cut into the hillside or like a slope so that the opening of the shipping container, it doesn't have to be a shipping container. It can just be a cave house.
Right.
You get natural light at the one end of it, but you dig in far enough that you get some of the naturally occurring insulation of the good earth.
Mm-hmm.
And then you're just like a hobbit. Like, you're not hiding from the world. You're just, all you've done is reduce your energy costs.
Right. And hopefully your land use and,
cool little cave house.
Yep.
And you can fucking grow carrots on the roof.
Right. Exactly.
If you want.
I mean,
or whatever.
There's all sorts of beautiful ideas, you know, all types of earthen construction or recycled tire houses and all sorts of things. Although I will say, in addition to reminding people who are attracted to this lifestyle that actually dense urban living is extremely efficient,
I will also
remind that, sadly, in many cases, the most efficient or the greenest building is a building that already exists.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Even something like the buildings that I work on, like Adobe construction or different types of earth systems that are, like you're saying, even though they have actually low insulation, low R factor, but high capacitance. So they retain heat, but they don't keep heat inside.
Mm-hmm.
They're like a battery. Anyway, doesn't matter. The thing is, all those cool things are still worse than just like trying to figure out how to make your home very efficient. If you can afford that.
Yeah,
you can
put the geothermal heating and cooling.
Yeah, you get the heat pump in there. You get the solar.
You put the coils underground.
Yep. Yep.
You know about the coils underground?
I know about the coils underground. Yeah. It's beautiful.
This is a way of cooling your house by using and heating it by using the natural insulating properties of
the earth.
Dirt.
Yep.
Dirt's cool, man.
It's so cool, man.
Some of the stuff dirt's getting up to, goddamn.
It's true, yeah.
Take it for granted.
If I can lash us to the film again before we are too far a sea.
Well, I think this is
relevant.
No, it's our show.
I think it's true, but I'll just remind people why this is relevant. All of these things are the basis for these ideas, and doesn't sound like we're being dismissive of objections about the modern world, which are many and extremely legitimate and often in a lot of cases.
Well, it's frustrating that because it feels like these people could be our comrades in fighting for a better world.
Yes.
But then it turns out that what they really want is to never rely on anyone ever again, which is sort of difficult to reconcile with socialism.
Yes. So this is, I think, what we got to get to, which is that it comes down to a psychological or whatever you can call it, like socially imposed ideology that becomes personal, where, like you're saying, it's more about being right, being unique. This is why when these people
I've got it all figured out.
Right. When somebody's approached by somebody else who says, hey, what if we turn this into a school or a network? Because just functionally, like mathematically, having a network of people supporting each other, you're going to be better off. They resist this, right? And if you try to approach them about, hey, seems like you have a lot of cool ideas and critiques, but you're also in your weird little society that you've created in your family, representing some of the most totalitarian instincts of patriarchy. And like your wife has to, like, she's only allowed to do three jobs. And one of them is like cleaning, one of them's cooking, and one of them's raising your strange number of children. So,
how could you ever tell Helen Mirren that she can't do something?
Right. I totally agree. Yes.
Who are you? The fuck are you?
Right.
You
know? Yes. What do you imagine yourself to be that you have this right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I think, I don't know what this is a request for on my part, that maybe we have to be educating people about healthy relationships or healthy self-conception at the same time as we're working on these questions about hopefully making dramatic shifts in lifestyle. I don't know.
Yeah. I mean, I think it does scare people away from potential alternative, you know, ways of improving.
Yeah. Although if I can be a little pessimistic, everything scares people away from, I mean, as soon as somebody mentioned that statistic about 100 companies representing 71% of emissions, that was like, can just wipe your hands off. Nobody has to do anything, even though that study actually represents end use as well. So it's they'll like count your use of gasoline as exons.
Okay.
So,
well, sure. And then there's embodied carbon.
Right.
Something like 18 to 30% of like global
is just like cement.
Carbon emissions production. Is just, yeah, cement production and transportation and stuff.
Correct. Yeah.
And this gets into the all the, you know, building new housing while apartments sit empty and things like this. We just need a, we need to let go of the idea that, you know, I can pursue my own comfort and my own ends, and all I got to worry about is me. Because no, we're gonna fucking cook, man.
It's true, exactly. I mean, it is. Yeah, if there's a failure in individual action, is that it's just inferior to collective action. But individual action is where collective action starts. So you do have to take steps. And the cool thing is, I will say that I don't mean to make it sound like it's just a bummer, nor do I mean to sound like a 1960s eco warrior or something. But honestly, it is cool to live with fewer resources consumed in your life, and it does make you feel good, and you realize that most
just
of the
pretend
stuff
it's your,
you don't really
pretend,
miss.
I feel like we could, like, you know, from hanging out with Aaron, I feel like we could probably get the bodybuilding guys on this.
Sure,
because they're so, they're, you know, once you're a macro freak, you're tracking resources already.
Yep.
So why not just start trying to, you know, but being one of those people whose year's trash fits in a mason jar, people.
Exactly. Yeah, gamifying zero waste.
It, exactly. Yeah. I want to talk about a couple people who deserve the French device for a second.
Great.
First of all, Nicolas Appert was active during the French Revolution and took part in the execution of King Louis XVI.
Like, personally?
Well, that's just what Wikipedia says. I assume he was just, like, there.
Okay. It's still pretty
but
crazy.
But taking part, like, his taking part is going, like, yeah!
Yeah!
Is that taking part?
I think so.
Wee!
yeah, it's
a bit. Oh, you know? I was pumping my fist.
He was. Yeah, he was. Okay.
Yeah, but sorry to the our French friend.
Manny. Yeah.
Manny Lazatru, I think, is... I've currently set her on a mission to find... They were handing out Paul Schrader postcards at Cannes.
We have two friends there.
I said, man, yeah, we do. I said, I'll send you my home address.
Okay, great.
I'll pay for the postage.
Yep.
Just, you know,
make
I
it
need
happen, whatever it takes.
Yeah. And she said, oh, fuck, I will. So anyway, sorry about the French thing. But, you know, I was reading about special economic zones.
Yeah, sure.
Because I was just checking in on what's going on with Honduras, Hoy en Día.
Mm.
And, enemy of the show, Peter Thiel, some other guys, they're basically trying to set up a kind of libertarian paradise on Roatan, which is an island off of eastern coast of Honduras. Eastern coast, right?
Eastern coast, yeah. I don't think there's a western coast of Honduras.
There's like a little, there's like 11 miles over or something. Yeah, I think so. And so he's trying to set up a special economic zone. Is basically a thing that a developing country can set up to entice the
capitalist investment and
investment from from like the US and such like places.
Right.
In order to basically like operate without government regulation or taxation at the same level that the rest of the country has.
Yes.
So it's a way to in a small area presumably immiserate part of their population to get foreign investment, while then in the capital of that country, for example, still saying, look, we treat you like human beings. And
we're seeing the benefits of it. Look at all this money that the GDP is going up. Yeah.
This is evil shit.
Yep.
Friend of the show, Zoomer Josh, and I just watched Walker last night, the Alex Cox film Walker.
I was just watching it earlier today. Mm.
William Walker, who was a filibuster. I didn't know about this term.
This is like a real AP US history term.
Yeah, our freebooter, these people are sometimes called. This guy was a lunatic.
Real psychopath.
Seems to me, and this is not really the process that that he goes through in the film, but I think maybe the film is very angry about the treatment of the Sandinistas in Nicaragua and was shot in Granada, Nicaragua in 1986 or whatever.
Cool.
Really cool.
Yes. Yep.
But William Walker seems to have been a guy who loved slavery so much, he kept trying to violate the sovereignty of other countries in North America to start a new slave state.
Yeah, trying to get backers in the U.S. to fund his... Again, this is not like mercenary because it's truly an ideological project, not for economic ends, at least indirectly.
And so basically with like a bunch of fucking mercenaries at his back and the backing of Cornelius Vanderbilt and like railroad baron types, he waltzed into Nicaragua and basically killed enough people that he installed himself as
the president.
Yes.
This is in like 1856 or something.
Yeah. With the blessing of President Franklin Pierce.
Yep.
And wanted to start like a new slave state, basically. And this is the same thing that Peter Thiel is doing.
I mean, it's the same thing Peter Thiel is doing. It's the same thing that presidents in some of these places, like the president of El Salvador, Bukele, and also
Mr. Bitcoin himself.
The president of Argentina, Milei. All these guys are...
Yeah. Mr. Cosplay himself.
That's right.
So humiliating that these contemporary, like, anarcho-capitalist fascist psychos are also such, like, losers.
I mean, surprising, not at all, but...
No, I don't mean to be, and I don't mean to be a return guy at all, but I feel like...
I mean, Walker was also, like, a little weak freak.
Yeah, I just know what I want from... I guess I would prefer a demagogue have a little shame about, like, being into fucking cosplay.
Sure.
You know?
Yep.
But maybe that's kind of not that relevant to
I don't know. I can't help but agree with you. It does seem like somehow it adds an air of... Like, a layer that makes it understandable why people get drawn into it. You know, they sort of see this person as maybe some type of representative of a higher class or like a brighter future.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I don't want this guy to be appealing. Like his positions are so unappealing, but then also it's the same thing with Trump. Ultimately, it's
right.
Like, not only is the stuff the guy is for objectionable to me, but even just like as a dude, as like a sort of as a figure, he sucks. He's just so lame.
Yep. Exactly. Yeah.
Anyway.
Yeah, and then we still do that. You know, it was like the Bolivian coup in 2019, where we also the U.S. was like, maybe we could just say that somebody else is the president. Would that work at all? If we just say this lady on Yes is the president, is anybody going to go with this?
And they're just throwing people in there who will. I mean, Honduras was the original referent of the term banana republic. That's what it was coined for.
Yep. Exactly.
These are just like. These are extractive.
Yeah, sites of low cost production.
States,
yes, exactly.
Yeah, for the global north. It's and I think what the film does, what the film identifies very effectively is like Fox talks about his absorption refrigerator, which by the way is the ultimate. It's like the basically the kind of technology that van life. Guys, refrigerators work off
because true.
You need a small amount of heat to like get the process started. So, all of those psycho white couples who have like a blog called Gypsy Wanderlust Chronicles.
Yes, that's exactly right. Yeah,
they have a refrigerator that basically works the same as this one, but he treats this machine. He refers to its parts with like. Human anatomical.
Yes. Yep.
Yeah. He calls it my baby boy. He names it fat boy. He's basically like, I mean, he sees himself as God, like creating Adam.
Yes.
And on the one hand, like it's very impressive that he's able to put this thing together. It's funny that it's not like, to my mind, the film doesn't really depict it as like a miraculous thing. It's just a type of technology that does exist, but not at this asparagus farm.
Right. Yeah.
But like, you know, I think I was talking about this on our Richard Jewell episode when I watched Paul Blart Mall Cop.
Okay.
Where it's revealed that Paul Blart, he has all these ideas to improve like customer experience
the flow,
at the mall.
Logistics. Yeah, you did talk
because
about
he's,
this.
And he actually could be like a gifted, I don't know, urban planner or like logistician.
Yep.
But he's putting his mind toward policing, maybe just because he doesn't know any better.
I mean, personally, this is why this is so frustrating to me, I will say, is that because there's such a low number of people willing to make the leap into this type of experimentation. And I will say it is cool to go do like a homesteading thing if you are trying to become like a demonstration or try things out so that they can later become wide practice in industrial agriculture.
Even just like make a new, if you're just trying to make a new tomato or whatever.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think that's worthwhile. Making a new cosmic crisp apple.
Totally. I mean, you see Santa Cruz tomatoes that I think require two waterings in their entire life cycle. Very cool.
It's cool.
But the fact that we have so few of these guys and yet they're so crazy is very frustrating. Because it's sort of like, we're, it's like already against the odds that you exist. and then to be wasted on this nonsense, I think is more yep. frustrating to me. You're like so close to being of great value to the people around you and to yourself.
Yeah, one of the things that's interesting about the Ford casting, because the part was written for Jack Nicholson, and I think you can smell it.
Yep.
That kind of reptilian charm that he has.
Well, that's like a Shining style descent of your whole family into your madness.
But also like a Witches of Eastwick style. Like, this guy is repulsive, and yet...
You can see why people are...
I like him, you know? Something about him. I think Ford... He was a carpenter. Like, he was a set carpenter.
Yeah, that's how he met George Lucas, right?
Apparently, he's doing a fair amount of just, like, legitimate carpentry in these sort of montage sequences. And, yeah, I don't know. I watch carpentry videos on YouTube. This is one of the things that smoothens my brain a little bit. Gives me a moment's peace.
Yeah.
And they... Oh, new iCloud terms and conditions. That's fun. My phone went off during the fucking show to tell me this. I watch a lot of these carpentry guys, and like what they're doing in order to make a living, like mostly you're just doing Adobe Premiere. Like, more of your time is spent doing the video editing and the you know, web mastering and stuff. But then what they're actually depicting is generally like they got a big slab of junk walnut from their buddy who owns the lumber store, but they're gonna like do a bunch of epoxy tricks and stuff to make it look, let's be honest, like fuck, and then sell it to some schmuck for like $15,000 because he wants a river table.
Right.
But I think the river tables, for people who don't know, is like, it's a piece of wood with holes in it, but they fill the holes with epoxy that generally they color blue.
Painted. Yeah. Yep.
It sucks. It's so fucking ugly, but they're very expensive and apparently in demand, I think, because they're in demand. Like,
people
want them because they're the one from the video, and then there's more videos about them because people want them because there's videos about them.
A legitimate Ali Fox style objection, I will say. That's a good one.
Thank you.
Yeah.
But these you know, these guys have, like, it's cool ideas. It's cool stuff that they're making. It's cool. Yeah. They're genuinely...
Great skill with a few tools in particular.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think using like... wood that would otherwise be wasted is a great thing to do. Also, I think, you know, acquiring and honing skills that are not fucking email job skills, good for all sorts of reasons, gonna be useful in the future in any kind of apocalyptic or non-apocalyptic scenario. Both. It's good for your, I think it's like probably good for your mind, keeps you from going Travis Bickle style insane.
Yeah, it makes you pay attention maybe to where these things come from, what their life cycle of like a tool or a piece of wood is, and just makes you a more conscious person, hopefully.
But one of the things that I've noticed about all these YouTube guys, and also we were talking about this, but the answer you always get when folks on the left are asked about preparation for societal collapse is not, you need to learn how to make your own sunscreen and make your own, you know, you have to learn how to grow potatoes.
And paper and,
yes. The thing they always say is build community, establish connections with people around you, because then you have a bunch of people together who have a diversity of skills by the very nature of like a bunch of people being together.
Yeah.
And,
this is like village logic. It's more efficient for one person to be really good at growing the food and one other person to be good at making the bicycles.
Exactly. Probably need more stuff. We need a third person, I think, in our little commune.
Yeah.
But yeah, I don't know. I was trying to track down this podcast that I listened to. Don't remember anyone's name who was involved with it. I will try to figure it out by the time the episode comes out, and I'll link to it. This woman wrote a book about, she's a academic, I believe. She wrote a book about basically not discounting communes and utopian projects out of hand.
This is a great question.
Did I say discounting? Not dismissing them out of hand. Because
that makes sense to me.
In all of these, even if they sometimes, not all of these, in many of these, even if they sometimes devolved into like harems infighting, like with the United Red Army just killing each other via exposure. So often when you have people sort of exploring a new societal structure, they will stumble upon something useful.
Yep, that sticks.
For example, the example she gave was community laundry.
Uh-huh.
There was, I forgot the name of the commune, but basically they had issued money, but there was some kind of a system of other people do your laundry tokens.
Uh-huh.
And there was also shared clothing, okay, where you could, or communal clothing, where you could have clothing that was yours if you really liked a jacket or something.
Right.
But then you are responsible for cleaning that thing.
Yeah.
So if you don't want to worry about laundry, because there's someone else whose job is laundry and they like it.
Yeah.
Then you can go grab you know, the nearest pair of pants that'll fit you off the rack. But if you want that special pair of pants that make you look, you know, dumb thick or whatever, you gotta
have
wash
your own,
them yourself,
take care of them. Yeah.
Which just seems like a perfectly reasonable way of kind of rethinking or honing. I don't want to say iterating. I don't want to use any tech language. I'm saying honing, like,
okay,
a
great, yeah,
like a knife.
Right.
Cooking, like a okay knife, like a nice knife.
Sure. I use
honing this particular aspect of social interaction. Where, yeah, like, you know, I don't like doing laundry, but if I can do something else in exchange for the laundry getting done, happy to do it.
I mean, this is what I meant by like being sites of research or experimentation. I mean, that's a word that they use in the film. You know, it's an experiment. I think that, right, is a real value, right, of this also, because you're right. Unfortunately, convincing people in like a massive urban center to make a big switch is tough. It's a little bit easier if you have an example and people have visited there, because there's a stupid little Airbnb that they go and say, oh my gosh, it's so cool that the chainsaws at the library, because I only use a chainsaw, mm-hmm, once a year, and why wouldn't, yeah, somebody else use it the rest of the time? That's so
cool. That is cool.
Right. It is cool. I mean, that's like in an intentional community where they're trying to solve some of these problems. I think it is real research for the future.
Right.
As long as, and I hope it's the case that that's how they see it, not as like, we're going to make it and these suckers are, you know, because of how they, right, believe in racial mixing. So we're never going
to. And also try to do it where you are.
Yes.
Like, don't go to Thailand. Don't go to, yep, Honduras. Don't go to rural Brazil.
Yeah. I think we got to return to that. And obviously, you know, I say this very conscientiously as someone who participates in, of course, unwillingly, but the gentrification of a place that was an indigenous area, a multi-indigenous area. It is just a straight up fact that if you go somewhere, you have to put in an enormous amount of effort to not be a suck on the area. And, you know, just the idea of like, I'm bringing in these new ideas, or I'm bringing in American income, or what's wrong? I mean, this is the hyper-individualism of again, this is like the neoliberal version of colonialism, because you are not a state. So you think, well, how can I be a problem?
Right,
I don't represent,
right,
even like a US or an Israel or something where I'm coming in and displacing people en masse. I'm just being me. You know, what problem can I cause,
right,
by coming into this place?
Yeah.
Not recognizing that individual behavior replicated thousands of times over is suddenly a massive social force.
It adds up.
Yep.
Yeah. Man. There's something, I mean, I think there's something very subtle, or fairly subtle, but telling or profound about the idea in the film that seems like it's going to stick.
Uh-huh.
Is that yellow fabric, like the coolest
sure,
thing.
Sure, yeah.
My girlfriend was telling me about, I think she listened to a podcast about this, or maybe read a book, I don't know, she's very smart.
Okay, agreed.
About these, well, watch it, buddy. These, it's her fucking birthday. This previously uncontacted group of folks,
yep,
who they were contacted by some, I think, English researchers. I believe this was in Oceania somewhere.
Okay.
Don't want to get it wrong.
Sure.
And so they came in, these British people came and learned all about these anthropologists. They came and learned all about the functioning of the society of these uncontacted people.
Mm.
And it was very like friendly. I think it was, they were, you know, as respectful of this culture as they could be, and everybody was on good terms.
Okay.
And when they left, some of their new friends from the uncontacted tribe said, we'd love to see London.
Sure. Yeah.
And they were really worried about sort of poisoning their minds or whatever, about spoiling them. But they brought them to London, and they visited London, and they had all kinds of fairly obvious
why do people like, live in poverty while there are people
where are you going all day?
Sure.
To work.
Yeah.
Like, what do you do? And like, why would you do that? It's like, well, to pay for all this stuff to buy the house. And they're like, what do you mean buy the house? Didn't your neighbors help you build it?
Uh-huh.
So that you would have one? You know, that kind of stuff.
Right.
And then they returned to the place that they had been living, and totally the opposite of what the anthropologists were worried about. They basically, they asked them, like, if there are any ideas they wanted to bring back. And I think I have this right.
Okay.
I think they said, not really. There is one thing, though. We really like Sprite.
That's great. Okay.
That's something you guys have, right. You guys have knocked that out of the park.
I think this is a plotline of Joe versus the volcano, but cool.
Maybe.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. I mean.
I don't know.
No, look, this makes sense. And to say that, one of the things I liked in the film is we didn't really delve into the Andre Gregory Christian missionary style of
J. Doof.
Yeah. Colonialism.
That's me.
That is right.
I'm a J. Doof.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I think, you know, one of the not so subtle realizations in the film is as much as Harrison Ford wants to distance himself from this guy, they
right,
represent
yeah.
similar forces at the end of the day.
Yeah. And he says, like, you know, what's what I love about you religious people is totally unpresumptuous.
Right.
But like, motherfucker.
Exactly. Yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
I would hate to be unaware like that guy over there who's totally yeah. different from me.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think it is, if a simple statement, a powerful one, to say that you, of course, will never see yourself as the bad version of the thing that you're doing. And I think right. it takes a very high, demanding level of either self-awareness or principled analysis to really figure out, is the effect you're having any different than the effect that these other people are having?
Well, look at the guys from the Are We the Baddies sketch on
right. yep.
Mitchell and Webb. One of yep. them, at least one of them is like a big TERF guy.
Is that true?
That's true.
A bummer.
Yeah.
I hate to hear
one
that.
One of them turned into like a, I believe he had a fairly productive conversation with past guest Jesse Thorne.
Oh, wow. Great.
Trans kids. All I right. think they had a fairly productive
Happy
conversation
to hear that.
That I believe resulted, though, in Jesse Thorne's life becoming extremely difficult due
I
to
can only imagine the
psycho
hell
British
that
people
he
reacting
waded
to
into.
It.
Yeah.
Yeah. Great guy.
Yep.
Love Jesse Thorne. There's, you know, I think throughout this, the hero of the film is Mr. Hattie, who
That's
is
right.
just like
yeah.
There's a great exchange that sort of gets to the bottom of society generally. It's early in the film where Allie wants to drive the launch that's taking them up the river
right.
to the town
yeah.
he bought. And Mr. Hattie says it's against regulations. And Allie says, what regulations? Because they're, you know, they're in the middle of nowhere. And he says, it's my launch.
Uh-huh.
I mean, ultimately, like, I don't want you to do it.
Yeah.
Like, it's my...
Respecting somebody else's rules for their stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's my
nice.
Thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. And like, that when you get down to it, just because you're not around cops, this sort of gets to another thing we talk about
it's
all
true.
The time. Like,
yeah.
why, in the absence of a carceral system, why follow the rules? Well, to get along with the people
yep.
near you so that everyone is having a decent day and doesn't want to kill you. But also they don't even have to not want to kill you, just so they, you know, like you and you're it's because it's unpleasant to see someone else like in pain.
Yeah. And I mean
it's supposed to be anyway, that people tell me that's
right.
That's what it's like.
You can object to other people's behavior, but it's one thing to object because it is causing you actual harm. It's another thing to object to imagined harm, which is usually.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
You're not inconveniencing yourself enough for my convenience somehow.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a beautiful exchange. I mean, he represents, I think, again, the healthy reaction of like, I'm piqued at some of the ideas you're coming up with. It seems cool.
Yeah.
So you accomplish
right.
some things. Also, just patently insane that, you know.
Yeah. There is a kind of relief at the end of the film, thinking about all of the people who have been a part of this project down the road, just going, remember that fucking guy?
Yeah.
But like they're all going back to their lives.
Right.
I think the only people who die are those weird mercenary guys in one of the greatest explosions I've ever seen in film.
Insane. Yeah.
Incredible.
I couldn't believe
this. And
you
also get the green fire from ammonia or whatever.
I was already impressed by it, and then they cut to a longer shot and the explosion goes bigger. I was just so impressed.
One of the
yeah.
greatest explosions I've ever seen. I am deeply concerned about
yeah. actual
Most
damage
of Belize
to the,
now.
Yes,
yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes. Agreed. I mean, Yeah, we didn't talk about it. We got a young Martha Plimpton in there. We got
daughter of Keith Carradine.
Yep.
Exactly Martha Plimpton right. is yep. the daughter of Keith Carradine. River Phoenix, who was going to play, he is going to play the young Harrison Ford in the few years, years after this.
Yes. With the beginning of Indiana Jones.
As his younger brother, Jadrian Steele. Imagine being River Phoenix and getting to the set. And being like, damn.
I'm not even in
that must be hard.
Yeah,
that must be
exactly.
must be difficult to be named Jadrian Steele.
Yeah, man, I really
Although,
got off easy.
Jadrian has, he went to Princeton and has apparently written some books as J.M. Steele. Scholarship.
Yeah.
That's got a Hoyt scholarship. There's so we got Maurice Jarre, who did the music for Firefox, just trying to see if there's any connection to Jason Alexander.
Yep.
Of course.
Yep. Beginning of the film.
Early role for him. For Helm.
Yeah.
And he will be he'll play the American Gigolo's friend in Pretty Woman just a few years.
That's right. That's exactly right.
Real piece of shit.
Yeah.
And also Dick O'Neill as Mr. Polsky.
The farmer. Yes.
The farmer. He is in The Jerk, which is just a movie that I like. So
both those things are true.
It's a good film. Taking Pelham 1-2-3 also. That's
That's a film, baby.
That's a film, baby.
We didn't really talk about the Paul Theroux. Gotta say that I was texting you about this guy. It's hard to bum out fans of him, but
I learned that he went to he was in the Peace Corps.
Yeah, he was.
And went to Malawi.
Yeah.
And to his credit, he assisted a political dissident in Malawi to the point that he got kicked out of Malawi.
That's
which
cool.
I think that's more than most Peace Corps guys do. But
sure.
He now lives in Hawaii. So I don't know how...
His whole thing, unfortunately, is being like the less bad version of the white guy going to a different place.
Yeah. Yeah, so, he's like a Hunter Thompson kind of guy.
Exactly.
I see these other guys and it's fucked up that they're doing it, but I...
Right. I'm not D.H. Lawrence.
You mean T.E. Lawrence?
No, I meant who I said, but you're also right about that.
You mean... Martin Lawrence?
Yeah, I guess I do mean that too.
I pointed this out
to
Aaron.
He went to the place where knights are.
I pointed this out to Aaron during in the intermission of Lawrence of Arabia.
Okay.
Black Knight is kind of a reverse.
Sure, yeah.
Lawrence of Arabia.
No, that's right. That's right.
Sort of a race swapped.
Yep.
Lawrence of Arabia.
I don't remember him putting out a match in the film with his willpower.
And he's a little less swishy than Peter O'Toole is playing it.
That's right.
What if a guy was so gay he could transcend race? That's sort of the plot of Lawrence of Arabia.
Honestly, I think that was kind of a historical type of a guy, maybe. I mean, you're basically just like being not heteronormative enough that you actually start to not be like...
Literally, like lowercase q queer.
Right, exactly.
So you're like, well, he's not regular. So
he actually might be okay. Yeah.
Right. And like, he's also... There's the bloodlust in him is an interesting wrinkle.
It is. It's the strange part of the film.
He's got a lot of interesting wrinkles, Peter O'Toole. Doesn't look like he used a lot of sunblock.
Nope.
Anyway, we were talking about
Martin
Lawrence.
Yeah.
Oh, Paul Theroux. There you go.
Yeah. Just mentioning that I think this is a brand of similar energy where it's... I mean, I think the man is in part famous for writing books that critique himself or are down on everybody, sort of like one of these equal opportunity critics or something. And, you know, he'll say that obviously it's bad to be a white guy going to these places, but also pretty cool to go to these places.
And I'm friends with some of the local guys.
Exactly.
And they let me in their bar.
Speak Spanish in a way that I'm sure
with
would
my
make
linen
me physically
pants.
Sick to hear.
Yeah.
And then also I text you about a bunch of extremely borderline pedophilic descriptions of young women that I guess are...
Yeah, that's a big thing with the libertarian guys. Like, one of the reasons that they want to get away from regulations always turns out to be...
sex tourism.
The age of consent.
Right, yeah. And it's just a bummer because you have a film like Saint Jack, which I think is a fun film at the very least.
Haven't seen it.
Okay. But also grounded in his maybe unusual relationships to sex work. Not just positive, but also...
Jeremy Allison, I think, a fan of that movie. But I do not believe a fan of maybe the
I don't think so.
Actions depicted.
Jeremy, good guy.
Jeremy Good Guy. I was going to say he'd be our guest on next week, but that would just confuse people.
It's just like he's been a guest on the show. Yeah.
Yeah.
Shout out Andre Gregory. I love the films My Dinner with Andre and Spagna on 42nd Street. So,
you ever seen a Master Builder?
I've never seen a Master Builder.
I have not seen it either.
No.
But that's the third Wallace Shawn, Andre Gregory collabo, right. I believe.
Gotcha.
Very funny episode of Blank Check about that movie because Jonathan Demme directed it. John Hodgman is the guest on that.
Makes sense.
And it's a like I gotta imagine like 2 hours and 10 minutes of Wallace Shawn impressions. It's just so it's very funny.
Sure.
They didn't like the movie.
Okay.
I think that's probably our episode on the Mosquito Coast.
I think so too. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, we forgot to the last fun fact that I had was that you were talking about William Walker earlier and rare shining moment for the British Royal Navy who turned him into the government.
Yeah, well, broken clock type situation.
So, yeah, this is just to say that it's good that the guy, I mean, I think he got
same casting director as Star Wars, Diane Crittenden.
Oh, wow.
I wonder how she thought of casting
some of the guys in this movie.
She's casting director on like a lot of stuff.
Wow.
Yeah. But then also like the Elektra movie with Jennifer Garner. But that's kind of a big one. That's probably our episode. We got to do the sexual obsession check-in.
Right.
Of course, Paul Schrader recently said this about his upcoming project.
I've never written a script about sexual obsession. And so that's what I'm doing now.
That's our boy.
He's never written a script about sexual obsession. And our question on this show is, how many films has he written that are not about sexual obsession? Mm. I actually think this is one of them. I think this is not about sexual obsession.
And we could get fancy and say this is like auto sexual obsession displaced, but
and
no,
he will
not
be on the show. Auto sexual obsession is disallowed.
Yeah. I guess what I mean is auto focus in some ways.
Auto focus will be on the show in due time.
Definitely. Yeah.
Some of my favorite Simpsons episodes.
Oh, sure.
Yeah.
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
I can't think of any.
Sure. You can't give an example at this time. But
I can't tell if this is a really good episode or a really bad episode.
Me neither. But people like the Casper episode, so who can say? Who can say?
Who can say anything is possible when you use the power of friendship, human society?
Don't
go live in the woods. You're going to die or blow up the woods.
Bring your buddy and make more buddies while you're out there.
Well, that's a little weird, because at a certain point, you're probably going to, like, the buddies are going to have to make buddies with each other.
Sure.
You know?
Yeah.
I didn't even touch on the River Phoenix Children of God thing, but River Phoenix basically lived in this, a pretty similar, maybe like a mixture of the Harrison Ford and Andre Gregory societies in Venezuela as a child.
I believe Children of God also had a brief presence pretty close to where I lived in the Yucatan Peninsula, if I'm not misremembering.
I believe that also. And they, in 1986, same year this came out, I believe is the year when they put it on paper that they no longer endorsed having sex with children.
Hey, that's great.
And prior to that, it was, I think,
doctrine.
Basically encouraged. Yeah. Not crazy about those guys.
Nope.
Do not join the Children of God. I don't know if you can anymore, but
Definitely don't try. Yeah.
And that's, I think, the show. We're going to be talking about Light of Day next week. Excited about that one.
Talking about Mother.
Joan Jett?
No, in this film, they say Mother, and then that's kind of a Mother film, so.
Oh, sure. Yeah, it's Paul Schrader's Mother film. I thought you were doing like a sort of a contemporary Stan culture type.
No, I don't do that type of
thing.
Stuff.
Stan culture. We're in talks. We're trying to circle in on a date with Stan culture.
Sure, yeah.
Thanks, everybody, for listening. Remember to subscribe, rate us, write a review. Seriously, the things in the iTunes store or wherever you listen to your podcast, they do genuinely seem to goose the
numbers.
The presence of the show. Goose the presence, everybody. If you like the show, tell a friend, tell your dad, write it on a piece of paper that you leave for your awful Polish boss
Right.
When he discovers your absence. Follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Pod Casty For Me. If you have any comments, questions, or concerns, or you're interested in co-hosting a two-person Paul Schrader podcast, you can email us at podcastyforme@gmail.com. Thank you to the several times aforementioned Jeremy Allison for our artwork. Light of day next week. Until then, as they say in Honduras, adios.
Bye.
What, am I wrong?
Nope, you're not.
Now this is podcasting.
There we go.